Good morning. Please refer to your bulletin and we'll sing the four stanzas of Light One Candle to Watch for Messiah. Advent is a time to celebrate God's love. God's love is pure. We celebrate by loving our neighbors as ourselves. God's love is everlasting. We celebrate by loving the Lord our God with all our hearts. God's love is all-powerful. We celebrate by spreading God's love to the world in need. God's love is freely given to all. Today we light the fourth candle, the candle of hope, the candle of peace, the candle of joy, and now the candle of love. The light of this fourth candle reminds us that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever should believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order to save it. Let us pray. Gracious God, as we ponder your great and eternal love, we thank you. We think of our own limited understandings of love. Teach us to love as you have loved, and help us to learn to share that love with the world around us. In the name of Jesus, amen. I invite you to stand and let us open our worship with a brief order of confession and forgiveness found on page 77 in the green hymnal. We invoke the name of the true God, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are opened, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We read these words in the first letter of John. that if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us take a moment of silent confession. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. We'll sing the fourth stanza, O Little Town of Bethlehem, found in the middle of page one in your bulletin. God in his mercy has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority alone, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our service continues in the bulletin. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
O Lord, have mercy and come to us.
Come, Lord Jesus.
O wisdom proceeding from the mouth of the Most High, pervading and permeating all creation,
come and teach us the way of prudence.
O Adonai and ruler of the house of Israel, who appeared to Moses in the burning bush and gave him the law on Sinai,
come with an outstretched arm and redeem us.
O root of Jesse, standing as a sign before the peoples, before whom all kings are mute, to whom the nations will do homage, come quickly to deliver us. O Emmanuel, our King, our lawgiver, the anointed of the nations and their Savior, come and save us, O Lord our God. And I bid you to pray with me the prayer of the day. Stir up your power, O Lord, and come. With your great might, give us your help, that whatever is hindered by our sins may be speedily accomplished by your grace. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Congregation, please be seated. It is with great joy that I welcome the following. If you're here, please join me here at the baptismal font. Benjamin and Rachel and their children, Daniel and Abigail Schweitzer. Joey Wallenberg, Nicole Jensen, and Gibson Wallenberg. Macy and Kayla Jensen are not here, but we'll welcome them as well. Pam Sorgatz. Dana Gettle, Mike and Judy Binger, Travis and Kelly and their children, Addison, Mackenzie, Jackson, and Charles Binger. They're on a vacation. All right. Dan and Tracy with their children, Gavin and Ashlyn Nowaki. And Dan is working up at the Capitol, right? Oh. Well, we'll include him in our prayers. Christine Peterson. Kim and Kimberly and Alexis Olson. Alexa says she sticks out of the stores as a sore thumb. I said, enjoy it now because it's not going to happen after this. No, we welcome all of you. Wow. Also not with us today as Bill and Michelle Ewes will be joining us as well. Beloved in our Lord, Jesus Christ said to his apostles, whoever confesses me before men, I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. Lift up your hearts, therefore, to the God of all grace, and joyfully give an answer to what I now ask you in the name of the Lord, and I will help you through these questions. Do you this day, in the presence of God and this congregation, acknowledge the gifts that God gave you in holy baptism? If so, answer with me, yes, I do. Yes, I do. Do you renounce the devil and all his evil works and all his evil ways? If so, answer with me, yes, I renounce them. Yes, I renounce them. Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, and in the Holy Spirit? If so, respond with me, yes, I believe. Yes, I believe. Do you hold all the prophetic and apostolic scriptures to be the inspired word of God, and the doctrines of the Lutheran Church drawn from them, and the confession in the small catechism to be faithful and true? If so, answer with me, I do. I do. Do you intend to hear the word of God and receive the Lord's Supper faithfully? If so, answer with me, I do by the grace of God. I do by the grace of God. Do you intend to live according to the word of God and in faith and word and deed, to remain true to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, even to death? If so, answer with me, I do by the grace of God. I do by the grace of God. Do you intend to continue steadfast in this confession and church to suffer all, even death, rather than fall away from it? If so, answer with me, I do by the grace of God. I do by the grace of God. Do you desire to become a member of this congregation? If so, answer with me, I do. I do. Will you support the work of our gracious Lord, who has given our congregation with prayer and gifts that God has given you? If so, answer with me, I will with the help of God. I will with the help of God. Upon this, your confession of faith, I acknowledge publicly that you are members of the Evangelical Lutheran Church and Christ the King Lutheran Church. Receive the Lord's Supper and participate with us in all the blessings of salvation that our Lord has given his church. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for your great goodness in bringing these, your sons and daughters, to the knowledge of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and enable them both with heart to believe and with mouth to confess his saving name. Grant that by your word and spirit they may continue steadfast in the one true faith and the fellowship of this congregation, as together we await the day when all who have fought the good fight of faith will receive the crown of righteousness. Well, we pray this through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Dear friends, would you give God the glory for these people with a round of applause? Since the founding of this congregation, you are probably the biggest group of people that we have received. God is doing amazing things, and he's doing amazing things through you. And we are so pleased with your desire to be part of this congregation. We give God the glory, and we look forward to the good things that he has laid out for us that will involve your participation too. And so as you come by me, I'll extend the right hand of fellowship representing the congregation. The Lord God give you peace. Amen. So come forward, and you can return back to your seats. We're done making a spectacle out of you. Pam.
Thank you.
Dina, Judy, Mike, good morning. Peace of the Lord. Peace of the Lord. Thank you for doing this. Gavin. Okay. Gavin, come on. You bet. Yes, sir. You bet. Kimberly. Thanks for being a big thumb. We will have special music.
Who laid to rest on Mary?
Wow. Thank you, Ashton. To God be the glory. Let us hear from God. Reading God's word today is Debbie Vanderhorst.
Our first lesson this morning comes from the book of Micah in the 5th chapter, and it's about he will be their peace. From the smallest of the tribes of Israel will come forth a ruler. He will stand like a shepherd among his people and lead them to righteousness and salvation. This was the message of the prophet Micah to a nation that had been battered and bruised by her enemies. One is coming who is filled with the strength of the Lord God of Israel. Micah 5, 2 through 5a. But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from old, from ancient days. Therefore, he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has given birth. Then the rest of his brothers shall return to the people of Israel. And he shall stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall dwell secure. For now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be their peace. This ends our first reading.
The psalm chosen for today is Psalm 80. We'll read this responsively by whole verse. Verses 1 through 7 is found on the bottom of page 2 in our bulletin. Hear, O shepherd of Israel, leading Joseph like a flock, shine forth, you that are enthroned upon the cherubim, in the presence of Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh, stir up your strength and come to help us. Restore us, O God of hosts. Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved.
O Lord God of hosts, how long will you be angry despite the prayers of your people?
You have fed them with the bread of tears, and you have given them bowls of tears to drink.
You have made us the derision of our neighbors, and our enemies laugh us to scorn.
Restore us, O God of hosts. Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved. Psalm 80.
Our second reading is from the book of Hebrews, and this is about a second order that is established. The sacrifices that were made in the Jewish temple year after year were ineffective against sin. The offering of bulls, goats, and other animals could not take away the sin of the people. Jesus came to establish a new order. He would be the one to fulfill God's will. The sacrifice of Christ's body changed everything for humanity. Hebrews 10, 5 through 10. Consequently, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body have you prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure." Then I said, "Behold, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written of me in the scroll of the book." When he said above, "You have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings, these are offered according to the law." Then he added, "Behold, I have come to do your will." He does away with the first in order to establish the second, and by that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. This ends our second lesson.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel. Together we speak the verse, Alleluia. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the first chapter, beginning at the 39th verse. Glory
to you, O Lord.
In those days, Mary arose and went with haste into the hill country, to the town of Judah. And she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the baby leaped in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. And she exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why is this granted to me, that the mother of my Lord shall come to me? For behold, when the sound of your greeting came to my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord." And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked on the humble estate of his servant. For behold, from now on all generations will call me blessed, for he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of humble estate. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent empty away. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his offspring forever." And Mary remained with her about 3 months, and returned to her home. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Children, would you come forward for a message, please? Go ahead and have a seat there. Well, good morning. Good morning. It's good to see you. Did I sleep in? No, sir. I didn't get to sleep in. We were out doing the live nativity and left, and there was some still cleanup to do, and I went straight to bed and got up at 6 o'clock. How about you? Nah, you slept in. Good for you. You slept in too, Abigail? All right. Lucky you guys. Let me give you something to think about, more than just sleeping in. Where do you expect kings to be born? In big cities or little cities? In towns? Yeah? You're kind of getting ahead of me. I thank you for that. Normally, we expect important people to be in big cities, right? But what we had in this wonderful message from Micah, and we had actually one of the last places, if you got to see the live nativity stuff, there was this last place. Yes, you did. You came through. Where Micah, the prophet, talks about Bethlehem. Bethlehem was a lot smaller than Waseca. It was actually probably a lot of people just kind of, it's one of those towns, you know, when you're driving and you're riding with mom and dad and you blink, you miss it. It's probably so small that you just drive through it so quickly. But this Bethlehem was an important town. It was a place where King David was born, but more importantly, it was the hometown of Joseph. And Joseph is the guardian of our Jesus. And Jesus is born in Bethlehem. Yes, you do have a flower. It's a pretty flower. And Bethlehem is where our Jesus... Now you're going to talk about this. Some of you did this with the Sunday school program last week, and we're going to hear about it after Christmas, about the three wise men, the Magi, are going to come, and they're going to go to Jerusalem, because Jerusalem's the capital, and we expect kings to be born in the capital. And they had to go back and look in the Old Testament and found out that, no, the king of Israel was going to be born in little Bethlehem. You know, God does this all the time. He uses things that people don't expect to do his wonderful work. In a little town of Bethlehem, in a simple stall, cattle stall, or a stable, or some simple dwelling, our Jesus was born, not in a castle. That cross that's lit up behind me reminds us that God saves the world not in a phenomenal, magical powers, but through the shame of a cross. He saves the world. The Bible says that if we would look at Jesus, we wouldn't think he was like a handsome movie star. We probably would have gone, he's just kind of an average guy. God uses different things that we don't expect to use for his salvation. And here's the thing, even as little as Abigail, even as little as Gibson, you all can bring the good news of Jesus. I remember when one of my daughters was really little, and she asked her uncle, "Do you go to church?" And he goes, "No, not really." "You should." She was 4 years old.
Yeah.
So you're not too little, as much as Bethlehem wasn't too little to share Jesus. You are the right age to share Jesus. You're a big boy, yep. And no whether you're little or big, you can share the good news of Jesus. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, we are all excited about celebrating your birth, and it's coming so quickly, Lord. And with those comes the time to be with family and gifts. But we need to remember, Lord, that even in the small things, you do amazing things. And I know, Lord, that you do wonderful things through these small ones of yours. Dear Jesus, give us the ears to hear, even from children, your gospel. Thank you. In the name of Jesus, amen. Okay, so here's the deal. I got the bulletin, and there was some candy canes. This is going to be a tough one for me. So there's either candy canes or M&Ms. So one or the other, if you like M&Ms.
One or two.
So if you want a candy cane, take that. Daniel, I'm going to need your help. Would you hand out the bulletins too?
Yep.
And then I'll make sure you guys get what you need. Okay, so.
Abby wants the candy cane and I want M&Ms.
All right, sounds good. Here you go, Abigail. Who wants a candy cane? Anybody? Nope. You'll take one? You want one? Thank you. Gibson wants one? All right. Here you go, sir. All right, very good. Thank you. Thanks for being patient. Okay. Very good. All right, take one for yourself. Thank you, sir. If you turn into your green hymnals to hymn number 28, Savior of the Nations, Come.
Thank you.
basis for today's message is from our Old Testament reading, Micah, the 5th chapter, specifically verses 4 and portion of verse 5. And he shall stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall dwell secure. For now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be their peace. Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Dear brothers, dear sisters in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. You can almost close your eyes and imagine what it's like. Tranquil, quiet, undisturbed, peace. As a grandfather, I love my grandchildren more than life. I love them, and I love it. When they come and visit their grandparents, however, I must confess, after the couple of days with a gregarious, spirited kindergartner and her little sister that wants to keep up with her, or a baby like last night that cries in the middle of the night, waking everybody up in the house, when they go, I'm kind of glad. But make no mistake, we've already planned when they're coming back. Both Grandpa and Grandma breathe a sigh of relief when peace resumes in the house. Oh, I long for them to come back. But after a couple of tornadic days, peace. Peace. Of course, grandparents aren't the only ones. Parents. Parents coming and going wherever the schedules of their children take them. Oh, peace. Peace of heart and mind and soul. And it's not just parents, it's all of us. Regardless of who you are, it makes no difference. In this materialistic consumerism culture like ours, enough is never enough. Oh, we suffer so many disturbances, do we not? Violence, the fear of violence. Through a social media app, half our school district wasn't at school just about because of some silly threat. And it needed to be taken seriously, but, oh, really? There's anger. Palpable anger, even in this season of joy. Greed. Oppression. Wars and rumors of wars. And mind I remind you that we have a pandemic going on? And of course, the fear of death. Families are being disturbed. There's always the ongoing of divorce, custody battles for children. There's these horrible things where people actually are predators on our children for gratification that is beyond my understanding. And then there's identity theft and all these other disturbances. Lord, come quickly. In case you think I've forgotten, I haven't. I know by the end of the week is our Christmas celebration. And maybe you like me are feeling right now, I don't know, but maybe by Friday night I'll feel more at peace. You know, Christmas Eve. With the candlelights and the sweet music, the greetings and the well wishes of family and friends. Maybe that's the best hope that we have here in Christmas 2021. Because we know that as soon as December 26 rolls around, and granted, it's going to be a Sunday, but you know, Monday's coming and it's business as usual, right? All the more reason here on this last Sunday. I know that you're chomping at the bit. That last hymn had just some wisps and some hints and preludes of Christmas. You want to break through the gate and start singing those Christmas songs. I know you do. I do too. But in the season of Advent, on this last Sunday of Advent, let us take some time and talk about what we all yearn for. Peace. And it comes in the good news of one wrapped in swaddling cloths and found lying in a manger, as we're told. God wants us to have it. So much that God takes on human flesh and to give us a lasting peace. He will be our peace. It's been the theme in these last couple of weeks, going into the first Sunday of Advent and then our Advent worship and then the beautiful display. It was our job to be like prophets of old, to point to Bethlehem hundreds and hundreds of years before Jesus was born. It's been the theme here, Old Testament, and so it just seems appropriate that one more time, it was our last station to focus on the words of Micah, the prophet, who speaks of little Bethlehem, O little town of Bethlehem. But more importantly, he speaks about not so much Bethlehem, but who will come out of Bethlehem. And he, that is, the coming ruler of Israel, shall be their peace. So at the divine service of every Christmas Eve, the prophet Isaiah proclaims that the Messiah will be the Prince of Peace, another booth that we had in the display last night and the night before. In the Old Testament, St. Paul goes one step farther, and he echoes that of the prophets in Ephesians chapter 2, for he himself is our peace. And so the Lutheran question today is, what does this mean? Was ist das? It means that if we have Jesus Christ, we have peace in the fullest sense, not what the world can manufacture, but that what only Jesus can give. And we all know, just as you and I have been baptized into Christ, we've put on Christ, as Paul says in Galatians chapter 3, but we all feel a sense of illness. We miss the sense of being at ease. We're restless. We're insecure. For me, I'm attacked late at night. Everybody's in bed, and I'm walking the hallways looking out at that empty barnyard going, tell me, Lord, what's next? The devil is constantly waging war against Jesus' people. People like you, God's people. And one of his favorite tactics is to whisper in our ears, to create doubt in the minds of the faithful. And at times that doubt focuses on whether one man, can one man really do this? One man really atone and pay for all my sin? Pay for the sin of the whole world? Can one dude do this? And so somewhere in us, it conjures up this idea that I have to participate in this. Jesus did most of it, but I got to cinch the deal. I got to finish it. And somehow, I have to help out to avoid the wrath of God. But listen to what God's prophet Isaiah says. All we like sheep have gone astray, and we have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. And Micah continues the same idea later on in the 7th chapter. Who is a God like you, pardoning iniquity and passing over transgression for the remnant of his inheritance? He does not retain his anger forever, because he delights in steadfast love. He will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquity underfoot. You will cast all our sins into the depths of the seas. So if you're thinking you have to earn this forgiveness in any way, shape, or form, you're really going to miss the purpose of Christmas. Repent and believe in the good news. And in believing, you will find peace for your soul. Is there anything in your past that haunts you? Anything at all Anything that you would be ashamed of if somebody would know of your past? Does it still bother you? Or maybe you're good like me and you can just kind of stuff it away and just ignore it. I know way too many people, who think that God is just waiting to hammer him, to lower the boom. Hearts never at rest. Minds never at peace. But the peace that we desire comes only from Jesus. He is the antidote of a guilty conscience. Again, from God's word, not from this joker's ideas, from Hebrews, the 10th chapter. How much more will the blood of Christ, who through his eternal spirit offer himself without blemish to God, purifying our conscience from dead works to serve the living God? And since we have a great priest from the house of God, let us draw near with true hearts in full assurance of faith, with a heart sprinkled clean from any evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Our souls desire to be clean. And Jeremiah the prophet says that God will forgive their iniquity and he will remember their sin no more. For all the times you stubbornly refuse to let go, God has taken your sin, has washed them away from you, and through the blood of Jesus Christ has forgotten about them. So, dear Christian, why should you remember them? Repent and believe in the good news, and in believing, you will find peace for your soul. There's an old saying that no man is an island. In other words, we're created, we're wired to be in community. We're wired to have family. We're wired to want to be part of something. And we give God the glory that 30 people decided to be part of this community of faith. And we welcome you, and we give God the glory for you. And we want you to do the things that we do to proclaim the mercy of God through word and sacrament, and share that love. The desire to be part of something goes in so deep in us. This is what the draw of the wickedness of urban gangs, the experts tell us. We all want to be part of something, and we all want to be part of something that matters. And in the human sense, it can be twisted like a gang. But with word and sacrament, it has purpose. That's what this is about. We need to remember in holy baptism that we're all members of the family of God. All members. I'm the weird uncle. That's okay. We can deal with that. But we're all members of the body of Christ. God himself says through his apostle in Ephesians chapter 2, you are fellow citizens of the saints and members of the household of God. We're all family. You're all my brothers, all my sisters. And we are heirs together in the kingdom of God. From Romans chapter 8, the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs in Christ. You see, Jesus has done everything for you. His perfect life, his death, his resurrection is all done for you so that you would have peace. Repent. And believe in the good news. And in believing, you will find peace for your soul. And the final obstacle, it stalks us. It stalks us like a lion stalks a prey. It's a word that strikes fear. Death. For some reason in our country, we think we can postpone deaths in some way, and yet we have a culture of death. It's really a contradiction in its workings. We're consumed many times with this idea, especially in this time of pandemic. And in the process comes our insecurities, our restlessness, our uneasiness. And if it isn't about our own death, it's the death of a loved one. Perhaps the most shocking thing as we dealt with the beginning of this pandemic were those horrible, horrible stories, and maybe you know some personally who've died in a hospital, not with family members around. Oh, the horror of it, dying alone. And if that isn't enough, we're reminded that we are frail human beings with aching backs, sore feet, stiff joints, failing eyes, failing hearing, and our mortality is constantly in front of us. It becomes the source of our anxiety. Jesus has conquered death, and through his death, death has been reduced to a gateway. Death brings heaven, and with heaven comes resurrection. So why would we be afraid? Oh, we don't put the Lord to the test. But the scriptures are clear in Old Testament and New that Christians do not need to be afraid, because even though we die, he will walk us through that valley of the shadow of death. So why are we afraid? Repent. Repent in the good news and believe, and you will find peace in your soul. Peace. Oh, peace. Maybe that's it. Maybe that's what makes Christmas Eve so special. We yearn to be back out in that pasture. We yearn to have the angels before us. We yearn to hear glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace among those whom he is well pleased. Dear brother, dear sister in Christ, look to that cross behind me. Look deeply at that cross. That is a sign that God and sinner have been reconciled, and you have Christ's peace. He is our peace. Amen. The peace of God, which surpasses all our understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen. Would you confess your holy faith with me? Today we're going to use the Nicene Creed found on page 84. Please stand.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
As our offering is brought forward, we'll sing Create in Me. You'll find the words printed on page 4.
Thank you.
Merciful Father, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, our possessions, all signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Advent dialogue is found in page 4. Lo, he who is coming has come.
We welcome him with thankful hearts.
Lo, he who has come is coming.
We wait for him with fervent faith.
Lo, he comes.
Even so, come, Lord Jesus.
Lord, loving Father, with the whole church on earth, we cry, O come, Emmanuel. Rescue us from the powers of sin and death and the devil, and bring us at the last home to you in your glorious kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious Lord, fill our hearts with your peace, which passes all understanding. Bring hope to the hopeless and rest to the weary. Guide our lives in visible ways, just as you guided shepherds and wise men to the infant Jesus. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And just as Joseph and Mary made the long journey to Bethlehem, grant traveling mercies to all those who are making their way to their loved ones this week. Protect them and keep them safe, that they may have a joyful reunion. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Everlasting God, you are the source of all goodness and mercy. We pray for those near and far who have been devastated by violent weather. Grant your grace and healing power to all who are in need, whether in mind or body or spirit. Bring wholeness and health to all those who eagerly await the coming of the Lord. And we pray especially for Jamie, for Jill, for Barb, and for those whom we name in our hearts at this time. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
As you taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Receive the blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Be seated briefly for some announcements. Well, good morning, all of you. Welcome to our visitors and welcome to our new members. We are so thankful that God has brought you to us and that you are in our fellowship. I just continue to be just overwhelmed with joy, especially in the work of the fruitful labors of so many of you that participated in the planning and in the execution of participating in the live nativity. I have the joy of, I think with the exception of somebody who just drove right past me, I have welcomed, there was 450 cars that went by, and most of them I welcomed them. I was accused of sticking my head in their car to warm up. That's not true entirely. But at any rate, I would say every 2 out of 3 cars, people just thanked this congregation to be part of this, to point to Jesus as the prophets did. And you know, there were some people that were clearly church folk, as I would say, and maybe there were some that this just isn't their thing. And they heard the story of Jesus all the way back from Genesis. And so thank you, congregation, whether you supported in prayers or your sweat labor, in particular, Betty, your creative energies, thank you. To God be the glory. Naomi, thank you for riding herd on us all and all those who participated in any way. Froze out there, direct traffic. It's just to God be the glory. We have an opportunity, and we especially extend an invitation to those who are new members. We have a tradition of a progressive dinner. You'll see details in the bulletin insert on backside of your bulletin insert. There's a sign-up in the narthex, so please consider participating in it. It's a good time. It's just nice to let your hair down and just, you know, we were accused at one place of laughing too hard, so, you know, that's the story of it. Otherwise, there's a lot going on. Please look at the schedule in the back of the bulletin. It's all accurate with the exception of we will not have women's Bible study on Thursday, but otherwise everything else is to be scheduled. We've got a busy, busy end of the week. We have a 5 o'clock Christmas Eve service. We have 11 o'clock Christmas Eve service. Each of those services are just a little bit different, have their own flavor, and then a Christmas Day service, as well as on Sunday the 26th, we have one service at 9:30, and we'll have a baptism of Croy Dwayne Preston, my grandson. So, are there any other announcements that need to be said? Oh, as you prepare your hearts and minds for Christmas, as you welcome your family, as you go to family, go with God. We'll sing our final hymn, Of the Father's Love Begotten. It is, my mess here. It's number 42. And one final word, those new members, I have bags from the congregations of just greeting you. So please see me back in the wreath in the back of the room. We'll get you some bags. And then come downstairs, everybody, and celebrate these new members. Hymn 42, Of the Father's Love Begotten.
Thank you. Lord, we will. Thanks be to God.